Now, for more on the latest developments in the maritime row between the Philippines and China, we're now joined by a distinguished professor at the Department of International Studies in De La Salle University, Renato De Castro. Professor, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina. I hope you're doing well.
Doing good. How about yourself?
Not bad, not bad.
That's good to hear. Okay. Let's move on. The U.S., Japan, and the Philippines forming a trilateral front, and with this, a commitment that the three countries will face China as a team of three. Give us the pros and cons of this trilateral front, as they call it, Professor De Castro.
Oh, well, of course, you create security partnerships because you have a common interest. The three countries have, of course, a common interest specifically in terms of maritime security and also, of course, strengthening their respective economies in case in an era of what we call de-risking or decoupling, especially in the case of the Philippines. If you really want to assert an independent foreign policy, we have to ensure that our economy is not dependent on one single power. So the key point, of course, is diversification and, of course, relying on other powers in the region that would, of course, enable us to exercise independent foreign policy on the basis, of course, of a diversified and, of course, stable economy. And that's where I believe this trilateral security partnership comes in.
Mm. On the flip side, though, any ramifications, possible ramifications?
Well, of course, in every security cooperation, it's supposed to create tension. It will, of course, cause discomfort to some countries. But of course, you form this primarily because of the fact you want to deter and cause discomfort to that country. So that's a reality of international relations.
Mm.
You know, I guess this is already being watched by our big neighbor out there.
Because I was going to ask you a question as well, that how can this not be seen as a step towards escalating tension between
reality,
China and the Philippines?
Because where China puts us in a catch-22 situation. China applies gray zone operation, and we just see it recently with the Chinese putting down the 300-meter buoy at the entrance of the Bajo de Masinloc. And of course, Chinese actions directed against our resupply mission at Yuningshou, those are gray zone operation. China expects us to sit down and accept everything that China throws at us. But you have, of course, a willing strategic ally, the United States, and of course a security partner that is, of course, more than willing to assist us. So why not form the security partnership? So you cause us discomfort, then we will return the favor in return. Doesn't Chinese action cause us discomfort, cause us tension? So let's give China also that compliment.
Well, in the meeting that the three countries had on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly, they discussed as well possible activities to boost cooperation, including the creation of what they call a work plan. What form will this work plan take, Professor De Castro? What are your expectations?
At this point in time, I think it will more in terms of maritime security, in terms of building up the naval capabilities of the three countries, more specifically, of course, in the Philippines. Focusing, of course, on the Philippine Coast Guard and, of course, the Philippine Navy, probably also enhancing our maritime domain awareness capabilities. And chances are, of course, you'll have what they call joint sail operations, that this will be a trilateral operation conducted by the Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Force, the United States Navy, and of course, the Philippine Navy, along with their Coast Guard counterparts.
Mm. Now, we know Professor, sorry to cut you there. We know what the Philippines is going to get from this trilateral action. But what will Japan and the U.S. get from this as well? What's in it for them?
Access to our territory. This is where the action is really happening. Not only, of course, in the South China Sea, West Philippine Sea, also, of course, north of Luzon, which, of course, the United States and Japan are also looking at a possible flashpoint. I would consider the quintessential flashpoint in the region. And I'm talking, of course, about Taiwan.
Mm. So then if they have access to our territory, what happens then?
Of course, just in case push comes to shove across the Luzon Strait, they'll be in a position, of course, also to address that that challenge that might happen if, of course, the push comes to shove over Taiwan, between China and, of course, Taiwan.
You mentioned this a while ago, the buoys that were set up by China. Of course, this is happening as the trilateral action or trilateral front. It was formed there at the sidelines of the UN General Assembly. I mean, forget about China. Let's take them out of the equation. What does this send to the rest of the world? What signal does this tell or send to the rest of the world, Professor?
Well, of course, that they're, you know, when you talk about alliances, minilaterals like this, is what you call minilateral cooperation. It is in the middle of what we call multilateral setting like ASEAN, but it's not as narrow as when we talk about the bilateral alliances of the United States, U.S., Japan, U.S., South Korea, U.S., the Philippines. So it's somewhere in the middle. Usually have, of course, formation of this, not because they like each other, but because, as you know, the euphemism goes, the fluid and changing security environment of the Indo-Pacific. So not because we like each other, but because we find it necessary to basically make certain adjustment, because we see the security environment as fluid, as changing, and of course potentially dangerous.
Mm-hmm. And it's fluid and it's changing. And in fact, there are two actions that are being awaited from the commander-in-chief, the Philippine government. I want to talk about the buoys that were set up first. The Philippine Coast Guard are waiting for instructions from their commander-in-chief what to do with this. Do you see this as whatever action the commander-in-chief decides to take? Do you see this as a potential for miscalculation, potential to escalate as well the tensions? Go ahead.
I don't use the term miscalculation. Everything is, of course, as a matter of calculated risk. Nothing in life is risk-free, right? We take the vaccine, it will have impact. So especially in the realm of policy, in the realm of diplomacy and strategy, you have to take calculated risks. Yeah, because what is life without any risk? So, you know, if the president would make a decision, he would have, of course, to take into account possible reaction and actions. But, of course, the worst scenario is to take no action at all. So then you get criticized. You're put in a catch-22 situation. Damn if you do, damn if you don't. So from my take as a defense analyst, China has always pushed us to the corner. China knows for a fact that we don't react. And this is something that China learned effectively when we did not do anything when China took control of Mischief Reef in 1996. Mm. So China has always put us on the defensive, you know, conducting operations that the harass and prevent our supply mission at Ayunging Shoal, swarming operation, of course, at Pag-asa Island, and recently, of course, the situation. Given the fact that, again, this is a matter of political decision, I totally agree with the Coast Guard spokesperson, Commodore J. Taliala. This is beyond the what I call the paycheck of the Philippine Coast Guard. This is a political decision that, of course, President Marcos will have to make to take.
Because when you look at it, of course, part of the game is to be able to sort of read what they're going to do next after the action that you take, right? Uh-huh. So at the very least, if the Philippines takes out the barriers, at the very least, China can always put up new ones. But on the other side of the spectrum, what can happen?
Well, China, of course, will react. Definitely threaten us, so forth and so on. So this is where I think, you know, the trilateral security cooperation could come in.
If
they would like to assist us, they would assist us. Then if we are bold enough, we can engage China in a game of chicken. If we're bold enough. Again, this is a political decision that the president would have to take. And I use the term, probably it's time for us to make a pushback. This is something that China, of course, would least anticipate, because from the perspective of China, let's just put the Philippines always on the defensive. Why not take the offensive, the pushback?
turn the tables on them. There's another move that's being asked of this current administration, and that's to file once again before the International Tribunal, this time over the destruction of coral reefs in the West Philippine Sea. Former Justice Francis Ardiles is saying now's the time because it takes a while before a decision is made. Your thoughts on that?
I'm sorry, I'm not a lawyer. I will not comment on that. I'm not a legal expert. Mm. My area is primarily diplomacy, strategy, security. When it comes to legal issue, I would have to say, you know, it's not my cup of tea. Mm.
But would you say, though, Professor De Castro, that all these moving parts, the fact that they're moving this time, can only speak well about the Philippines really trying to reclaim what is hers?
Yes, but of course, what is still lacking is the political will. The ability, of course, to take a calculated political risk. Because just like I say, everything in life has, of course, risks. And this is something that I think Filipino decision makers would have to take into account.
All right, Professor.
Just look at the case of Vietnam. Mm. You know, and in several instances, Vietnam is willing to take that calculated risk. Malaysia and Indonesia recently did it, especially Malaysia. We have to look at how Malaysia basically took the calculated risk when China told Malaysia, don't conduct any exploration in your extended continental shelf. Malaysia ignored that warning and did precisely what they intend to do, conducted a survey in their expanded continental shelf. Mm.
All right, final question for you. Professor De Castro, before we let you go. The Philippine Coast Guard waiting for final instructions from the Commander-in-Chief regarding the barriers set up by China. Is there a sense of urgency here? When should the Commander-in-Chief hand down his decision regarding the barriers that were put up?
Again, this is a matter of a political decision. I am not in the position to say so. Because, you know, again, the president has political accountability to the people. He would have to explain to the people if something worse happened, it escalates, then he will have to take what they basically ask. What President Truman said, the buck stops with him. Mm. I am not in a position to tell him what to do or what not to do. This is basically his stake. Referring back to President Truman, the buck stops with him.
But is there a sense of urgency?
Probably, you know, if I'll be asked, probably it's time that we make that pushback against China.
Professor,
at the time that China thinks we don't have that political will.
Professor Renato De Castro there of the Department of International Studies there at the De La Salle University. Thanks again for taking our call.
Thank you very much, Romina. Have a great day.
You too. Take care.